This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. The Political Development of American Debt Relief by Emily Zackin and Chloe N. Thurston. Published by the University of Chicago Press. Preface. The mortgage mill grinds on. In October 1895, Charles K. Holliday announced his candidacy for Chief Justice of the Kansas Supreme Court. Holliday was the son of a wealthy railroad tycoon, but he made it clear that he was the people's candidate. Mortgage foreclosures had devastated blameless Kansans, he declared. Crop prices had fallen, and debtors had been pushed to the wall by Eastern loan companies. Yet the legal machinery of debt collection continued to operate. "The mortgage mill grinds on," he proclaimed. "And the poor devil caught between the upper and nether millstone is crushed, worse than crushed, he is ruined for life." Holliday pledged that he would attend to debtors' needs from the bench. Holliday was appealing to the farmers of the state, who had long made debt relief a central feature of their movement. By the 1890s, Kansas farmers were well organized, active in politics, and devoted to the cause of debt relief. In 1888, when widespread crop failures plunged the state's farmers into debt, the Kansas chapter of Farmers Alliance called on the governor to convene a special session of the legislature to enact an emergency debt relief law. When that didn't work, the Farmers Alliance elected its own slate of representatives to the state legislature, promising that one of its first acts would be passage of a debt relief statute. By 1893, the state legislature passed two emergency debt relief laws. Kansas was not alone in trying to protect overindebted farmers. Throughout the 19th century, states passed a variety of laws to protect borrowers from ruin, and overindebted farmers described themselves as victims, not only of nature, but also of greedy lenders and corrupt politicians. Congress, too, passed a series of bankruptcy laws, and by the end of the 19th century, it had created a Bankruptcy Act devoted in large part to granting overburdened debtors a fresh start. Nearly 70 years later, in 1966, Julius Hobson, a community leader in Washington, D.C., and William Higgs, an attorney, pointed optimistically to this 19th-century regime of legal debt relief. In a manifesto addressed to Black Power advocates, they explained that there was already a set of laws enacted during the populist period to free the poor from oppressive debt imposed upon them through usury and exploitation by the rich. These laws, they declared, had been scarcely touched by America's poor Black people, who remain largely ignorant of this powerful self-help weapon within their reach. By the 1960s, credit in urban areas was widely recognized as exploitative. The resulting debts impeded financial stability for many of the residents of these neighborhoods. Hobson and Higgs argued that borrowers should avail themselves of these laws to cut away the burden of back rent, back payments on the family TV set or furniture, and unjust high-interest loans. They attempted to organize a nationwide campaign to mobilize low-income Black citizens to declare bankruptcy en masse. Crucially, Hobson and Higgs rejected the stigma associated with debt relief. Like Holliday, they argued that those who were not able to repay their overwhelming debts were not at fault. They urged people to recognize that powerful banking, industrial and political interests had spread an image of shamefulness about declaring bankruptcy. This shame, they insisted, stopped people from acting in their own interests. They argued that exploited borrowers could and should use bankruptcy law to strike deeply at the economic and credit institutions that depend for life upon the exploitation of a certain percentage of the population. They believed that 20th century debtors could free themselves from a ruinous credit system, much as 19th century farmers had done. Unlike their predecessors' campaigns, however, the Hobson and Higgs proposal met with resounding outrage and universal rejection. The Philadelphia Inquirer described it as a firebrand scheme. A Tulsa Tribune columnist warned that while this undertaking might hurt white lenders, it threatened to utterly ruin Negro proprietors and undermine what Negroes needed most, a growing middle class. Civil rights organizers were skeptical too. When the pair approached the Scholarship, Education, and Defense Fund for Racial Equality to help them publicize their mass bankruptcy movement, one officer reacted with a combination of disbelief and indignation, writing to a colleague, The only conclusion that I can reach, and that which was suggested to me by many of the people with whom I spoke, is that the filing of mass petitions would eventually lead to the termination of this credit system and contribute greatly to the end of the credit system in low-income areas. I should think that the denial of credit might work an insurmountable hardship on many of the people who are forced to live in that manner. There is no doubt in my mind that this result would therefore be undesirable. The organization declined to participate. There were no marches and no mass bankruptcy petitions. According to the Wall Street Journal, in 2 years only 25 people stepped forward to file. Reflecting on why the poor were so disinclined to participate, Hobson told the Journal that the plan sounds like an Alice in Wonderland thing and they just don't believe it. Americans have long understood that insurmountable debts are oppressive. Throughout the 19th century and into the 20th, indebted people engaged in large, vigorous campaigns to demand government protection from their grinding obligations. Their appeals to state legislatures across the country to relieve them of their debts also burst into the national arena, shaping the 19th century's periodic experiments with federal bankruptcy laws. By the close of the 19th century, both the states and the federal government had experimented with what were, in essence, early social policies designed to protect the overindebted. Yet by the second half of the 20th century, large-scale protests for debt relief had become much harder to imagine. No longer a standard feature of American political life, the political mobilization of debtors now seemed more fanciful than possible. This book is about that contrast, why debt relief was a salient political issue for so long and why it then ceased to be one, especially in a society still so dominated by credit. It is also about the U.S. constitutional tradition and the contradictions it embodies. Lenders and their advocates have often argued that debt relief is unconstitutional because the U.S. Constitution protects private property, contracts, and economic exchange from government meddling. Debtors, on the other hand, have argued that the Constitution requires government to protect them from permanent ruin and from the power of their creditors. Finally, this book is about how debt relief has been persistently refracted through America's long-standing racial and social cleavages. Scholars of the late 20th and early 21st centuries tend to treat the non-emergence of an organized debtors' movement as natural or inevitable, and they have identified the many challenges of mobilizing people around this particular cause. They explain that overindebtedness carries a stigma, and debt relief policy can be dry and complex, hardly the stuff of catchy slogans or impassioned calls to action. Questions of debt relief can also activate cleavages among current or would-be debtors, pitting those in need of relief against those concerned that debt relief might increase their own borrowing costs. These accounts seem to imply the persistent impossibility of debtor organizing, but that is the wrong way to think about debtor politics. The possibilities for organizing around debt relief have expanded and contracted over time, shaped by larger economic and political structures. Ideas about debt have in turn helped shape these economic and political structures. By studying the moments in which debtors were able to shape the law in their favor, our aim is to understand the conditions that facilitated their organization and influence, as well as those that undermined their collective mobilization. It is possible that another period of debtor influence is on the horizon. Nascent protest has again emerged to demand a more robust system of debt relief, and governments are again enacting relief measures. In its initial response to the pandemic, the federal government, as well as some state and local governments, enacted a range of protective measures for debtors, including eviction and foreclosure moratoriums, suspension of student loan repayments, and protection of stimulus checks from access by creditors. Many advocates for redistributive and protective government argued that these measures had not gone far enough and urged Congress to cancel student debt, abolish back rent, eliminate medical debt, and amend federal bankruptcy laws to offer more robust protection for those who had little hope of catching up on old debts. These demands for relief were bolstered by a growing network of organizations devoted to the plight of the overindebted. These new debtors' organizations are considerably smaller than those we chronicle here, and it is far too soon to draw conclusions about their influence, but their claims are strikingly similar. Like organized debtors of the 19th century, 21st century debtors' organizations point out that many people today also have little choice of whether to incur debt, and that economic conditions beyond their control have rendered them unable to repay. These new movements, like their predecessors, insist that governments have choices about whether to help lenders collect from debtors, and that when governments enforce unpayable debts, it helps the wealthy lender at debtors' expense. They reject any stigma associated with the inability to repay, and declare that public power can and should be marshaled to protect, not punish, an over-indebted populace. This book's attention to debtor politics reminds us that long ago, Americans also mounted large-scale grassroots campaigns for debt relief. These activists made radical claims about economic justice, and they reshaped constitutional law and the American state. As Julius Hobson understood, government protection from insurmountable debt is not an Alice in Wonderland thing, but a very old feature of U.S. history. Introduction. Bankruptcy is not a crime. Government's choices about how to behave when someone cannot repay a debt are both political and consequential. They can determine whether it's permissible to imprison a debtor who cannot pay, and what, if any, types of debt to forgive. They can establish the type and level of property one is entitled to keep in spite of unpaid debts, and they can decide whether and when to stop enforcing certain debts. Governments write the rules about what debt collectors can do to extract payments from debtors, and create and enforce standards about how one's debt history and ability to repay can shape future access to goods like credit and housing. Governments also help determine which creditors have priority when assets are liquidated to repay debts. As a result, governments' choices help shape how much risk borrowers may bear when they take on debt, and how much of that risk their lenders are forced to shoulder. The law shapes whether debtors who can't make good on their loans are protected or punished. Beginning very early in its history, the United States developed legal tools to protect insolvent debtors. By the end of the 19th century, it had created one of the most protective debt relief regimes in the world. This regime consisted of federal bankruptcy laws, buttressed by a host of state-level laws designed to protect debtors. In its aim to protect and rehabilitate the overburdened debtor, this system represented a dramatic reversal from its origins. The puzzling path of American debt relief. Bankruptcy is an ancient system, but for most of its existence, its primary objective was to provide mechanisms for the creditor to recover debts, not to provide the debtor with relief. In British law, acts of bankruptcy were originally criminal offenses, and U.S. bankruptcy law initially built on this punitive foundation. Debtor imprisonment was commonplace in the first decades of U.S. history, and the first federal bankruptcy statute was designed primarily to help lenders collect outstanding debts. Early on, however, the nature of bankruptcy law began to change. Its purpose was increasingly understood as protective, ensuring that the federal government would intercede between over-indebted borrowers and their creditors at the borrower's request, enabling debtors to escape ruinous obligations. Even before the 1898 Bankruptcy Act created a lasting bankruptcy administrative regime, this patchwork of state laws and a series of short-lived federal laws aimed to protect rather than punish those who could not pay their debts. That this system emerged is in some respects puzzling. Insolvent debtors, by definition, lack the financial resources to devote to pursuing political change. In addition, the very idea of government intervention in private economic arrangements seems to contradict long-standing and judicially enforceable constitutional commitments to limited government and private property rights. How is it that a nation so famously devoted to Lockean liberalism developed such an early form of economic protection for those unable to fulfill their legal obligations? This is the first major question we take up in this book, and our answer draws attention to the political and economic conditions of the 19th and early 20th centuries. Over this long period, the recurrence of deflationary economic crises, the presence of organizations willing to take up the work of collectivizing debtors' struggles into political demands, and the regional character of debt all facilitated debtors' political mobilization. We demonstrate that indebted farmers, in particular, exerted enough influence in their states to shape both state and federal policy. Because farmers were perennial debtors, concentrated in particular states, their representatives in Congress were able to insist on the adoption of debtor protective measures, even when creditors' representatives put bankruptcy law on the federal agenda. In addition, states' own extremely popular debtor protection measures enabled farmers and their federal representatives to resist the creation of any federal policy that was not at least equally protective. Thus, the existence of state governments and state-based representation in the national government endowed debtors with political power, enabling them to influence national bankruptcy policy in a more protective direction. As the bankruptcy scholar David Skeel has noted, the most obvious effect of federalism was to give voice to pro-debtor views. In this way, the long-standing decentralization of debt relief policy empowered debtors' movements to shape the law in their interests. Each time the 19th century Congress discussed bankruptcy law, representatives of agrarian states, typically Democrats or populists, described their constituents' need for relief and urged Congress to shield them from ruin. Nearly a century later, this process was reversed. When creditors' organizations became larger and more concentrated, they pressured Republicans in Congress for policy action on their behalf. By the late 20th century, the issue of debt relief was no longer at the center of either grassroots activism or state politics, and this lack of activity enabled creditors to undermine the federal commitment to debt relief with very little organized resistance. Even in the 1930s, a period of vigorous labor organizing, Congress created a new, less protective form of bankruptcy, known as wage-earner bankruptcy, with scant resistance from labor. Though this wage-earner provision was seldom used in the many decades after its enactment, it represented the beginning of what would become a decades-long campaign by creditors to rewrite the bankruptcy law in its image. Throughout the second half of the 20th century, lawyers and scholars continued to give voice to the interests of the over-indebted, but neither of the two major political parties embraced the cause. Large membership organizations, such as labor unions and civil rights groups, were also largely silent on consumer bankruptcy issues. With borrowers politically absent, lenders, particularly in the credit card industry, became the dominant voice in discussions about reshaping federal bankruptcy law. Access to bankruptcy, contracted as creditors organized around the issue of debt relief from the 1980s on. More kinds of debt were rendered non-dischargeable, and the concept of bankruptcy abuse was introduced into federal law. Now, those who sought to free themselves of debt through federal law were not understood as merely using the law, but suspected of abusing it. The 1990s and early 2000s witnessed an especially intensive organizational and lobbying effort led by the consumer credit industry. And in 2005, Congress passed the Bankruptcy Abuse Prevention and Consumer Protection Act, BAPCPA, which reduced the federal protection available to overindebted borrowers. The second major question we ask then is why 20th century consumer debtors were less organized around the issue of debt relief than their 19th century predecessors. Lenders had long opposed what they saw as overly easy debt relief, and household debt had become an increasingly large problem for wage-earning or consumer borrowers. Yet by the second half of the 20th century, debt relief, once such a prominent issue in national politics, had faded from both electoral and advocacy politics. Our explanation for the dearth of debtors' political mobilizing, again, emphasizes the relationship between economic structures and the viability of pro-debtor politics. 20th century consumer debtors faced a different economic, political, and interest group landscape from that of 19th century farmers, one that made it harder for the former to organize around demands for debt relief. The post-war decades were not characterized by the recurrent economic crises that had once taught farmers to think of themselves as debtors and collectively to demand relief. In addition, the political geography of debt relief was, by the end of the 20th century, no longer characterized by regional differences. where farmer debtors in the 19th century often used sectionalism to their advantage. The nationalization of credit markets and the concentration of the credit industry by the end of the 20th century helped shift political fortunes toward a more organized lender lobby. Finally, consumer debtors and 19th century farmers had different relationships to credit and to class politics more generally. Farmers had, on the whole, been able to borrow relatively easily, but after a long struggle to secure their members' access to credit, civil rights and women's organizations were reluctant to embrace the cause of debt relief. In their campaigns to end discriminatory lending, these organizations advanced an individualized notion of fairness that sidelined class-based political or constitutional appeals. Debtors and the Constitution. Of course, it is not at all clear where the U.S. Constitution stands when it comes to economic class or the distribution of material goods. Some have argued that the Constitution requires the government to protect citizens' material well-being. Others have argued that the existence of a secure middle class undergirds the entire constitutional system. However, a great deal of work about the American constitutional tradition has emphasized that, with small exceptions, the U.S. Constitution has been committed to a limited rather than redistributive government and to the protection of private property rather than the protection of impoverished people. Our study of the political development of debt relief suggests that neither account is quite right, or perhaps that both are right. The Constitution's protections for contracts and property rights have clearly acted as a brake on redistributive debt relief, and there is little question that the Constitution was written, at least in part, to ensure that democracy would not pose too great a risk to private property. In fact, several features of the Constitution were explicitly designed to protect wealthy minorities from the redistributive potential of majority rule. Not only did the framers worry about protecting private property in general, but they were clearly concerned about the power of debtors in particular. One of the virtues of the new Constitution, as some Federalists saw it, would be to weaken debtors who had already been able to threaten the sanctity of contracts. The framers succeeded in shaping the text of the Constitution, but they did not succeed in quashing the protests of overburdened debtors. Regardless of the Constitution's commitment to the sanctity of contracts, debtors have claimed a superior right to the government's protection across the 19th century and into the 20th. As one Gilded Age Kansas newspaper explained, "It is not sufficient to say that the man who makes a contract should stand by its provisions. He should do this if the terms of that contract and workings of the law under which it was made are fair and reasonably just. But where the contract becomes a robbery, and the state through unwise legislation is made a party to such robbery, then the people have a right to demand protection." The article went on to argue that the need to affirm the equal rights of debtors ought to trump the Constitution's restrictions. The Constitution may be unbending in its provisions concerning repudiation of contracts, but it is even more uncompromising in its guarantee of justice and equal rights to all people. The provision of debt relief was not merely good public policy, the article's author asserted. It was also the government's constitutional obligation. When debtors and their advocates argued for debt relief, they insisted that their standing as equal democratic citizens was at stake. Even before the U.S. Constitution was written, debtors claimed that in enforcing the repayment of insurmountable debts, the state was choosing to side with wealthy creditors at the expense of their freedom. Time and again, through the 19th century and into the Great Depression, organized debtors asserted that the government's choices were behind economic calamities like mortgage foreclosures, which might, to a lone actor or household, have seemed apolitical or inevitable. Borrowers, they argued, did not deserve to face permanent financial ruin, especially when their inability to repay was so often beyond their control. They called attention to the volatility of the economy in creating their plight and condemned government policies that tightened lenders' hold over their futures. Why, they asked, could their governments not stand with them, freeing them from the creditor's grasp? It did not matter whether debtors faced coercion from state actors or private lenders, they explained. each menace posed similarly serious risks to their freedom and political equality. When we talk about free and equal citizenship today, racial equality often comes to mind, but it is important to recognize that when white debtors appealed to these principles, their arguments were often either explicitly or implicitly racist. They often highlighted what they viewed as the unnatural and illegitimate nature of their subjugation by comparing it to and implicitly legitimating black slavery. During Reconstruction, for example, some debtors argued that having abolished the enslavement of black people, Congress also owed debtors freedom from the slavery that their debts imposed. As the century wore on, concerns about the racial subjugation maintained through Southern systems of indebted tenant farmers and sharecroppers rarely figured in calls for debt relief among white farmers either within or outside the South. Even when black slavery was not invoked, a vision of white, yeoman farmer citizens underpinned many demands for debt relief in the name of debtors' freedom and equality. Of course, arguments that the provision of debt relief was a constitutional obligation generally struck lenders as entirely backward. The state's role in enforcing debts looked to many elites like the straightforward and apolitical application of the law, and it therefore seemed quite natural for the state to enforce private contracts. Opponents of debt relief typically pointed out that the Constitution clearly protected private property rights and the inviolability of contracts. Debtors were asking the state to intervene in those contracts on behalf of one of the two parties, to redistribute property from the innocent lender to the borrower who had failed to fulfill his contractual obligations. To do so was not simply unfair, they insisted, but clearly unconstitutional. The Constitution empowers Congress to pass uniform laws on the subject of bankruptcies, but when this clause was written, bankruptcy was understood only as a mechanism to help lenders collect from insolvent merchants and traders. While the Constitution's bankruptcy clause did not seem to empower Congress to forgive the debts of overburdened borrowers, its contracts clause seemed to forbid state governments from offering this form of protection. In the early 19th century, therefore, the Constitution appeared to stand staunchly on the side of creditors. Over the course of the century, however, Congress proved a major site of constitutional transformation. In response to organized debtors, the federal and state governments created a legal safety net for those who could not repay their debts and gave the Constitution new meaning in the process. As it crafted increasingly protective statutes, Congress repeatedly reinterpreted the Constitution to expand the meaning of the bankruptcy power and, through it, the authority of the federal government to intervene on behalf of debtors. Some of these interpretations were challenged in court as a violation of creditors' property rights, but the outcome of these constitutional transformations was a federal policy regime that could protect insolvent debtors of any profession, allowing them to seek and then secure forgiveness of their outstanding debts, keep some of their property in the process, and begin their economic lives anew. By the end of the 19th century, bankruptcy law enabled people to use federal courts to escape debts they could not repay. It established a long-lasting federal commitment to the principle that government should not enforce ruinous debt contracts, that it should, instead, protect people with overwhelming debts, allowing them to start over, free of these debilitating burdens. Starting with the earliest debates about whether to adopt the Constitution, debtors also used state-level politics to reshape constitutional meanings. As Elizabeth Beaumont has argued in her discussion of Shay's Rebellion, we might even consider organized debtors additional founders of our constitutional system. Not only did they add debtor protections to state constitutions, but they also insisted that state governments pass emergency debt relief legislation. Early in the 19th century, the Supreme Court declared these laws in violation of the federal constitution. But despite the Supreme Court's reading, debtors continued to demand that states enact similar measures. Even when debt relief laws were arguably in violation of the federal constitution, the practice of passing these laws endured, and each wave of legislation set the stage for future debt relief efforts. As a result, state legislatures continually passed relief laws that pushed the boundaries of constitutional doctrine, until Supreme Court doctrine itself finally shifted to accommodate debtors' demands. States also passed other kinds of prospective, durable debt relief measures like property exemptions and these two shaped federal constitutional understandings. The cumulative result of these state and federal developments was a reading of the Constitution that emphasized the material conditions of freedom and the need for government to intervene in purportedly private economic exchanges. The first half of the book describes its development. The second half of the book investigates the waning of these constitutional claims. During the second half of the 20th century, class-based arguments fell further and further out of the mainstream of left-leaning constitutional politics, and the demands of 19th-century debtors fell with them. Though debtors had once contested a reading of the Constitution that privileged property rights and the sanctity of contracts, questions about the protectiveness of bankruptcy law came to be understood not through the lens of constitutional commitments, but as mere policy choices. The claim that true freedom and equality required economic justice, and a check on the powers of capital became less and less accessible, even to liberal advocacy groups. Several legal historians have described the existence of a U.S. constitutional tradition with distributional concerns at its core, and like us, they have noted its post-war decline. By the late 20th century, constitutional questions about private power and equal citizenship tended to be litigated and understood through the vehicle of anti-discrimination law, and anti-discrimination law itself moved away from claims about economic justice. Yet constitutional claims about economic equality and a broad middle class, what Joseph Fishkin and William Forbath have termed a constitutional political economy, were, for much of U.S. history, a central feature of debates about the Constitution and its meaning. In recovering debtors' influence and highlighting their successful claims for economic protection, we do not want to deny the strong influence of laissez-faire liberalism on American constitutional development. Instead, our goal is to emphasize that American constitutional development, like all of American political development, consists of multiple traditions. One of these strains has entailed a commitment to protecting economically vulnerable people. It was often realized through congressional statute rather than judicial opinion, but it teaches us to relegate Lockean liberalism to the role of powerful constitutional tradition rather than hegemonic force. The transformation of federal institutions. As Congress adopted an increasingly protective and redistributive vision of its constitutional powers to provide debt relief, it constructed new federal institutions capable of carrying out this welfare-oriented role. It enacted four statutes over the course of the 19th century. The first three were relatively short-lived, so that for most of the century, no bankruptcy law was in effect. Only with the Act of 1898 did Congress finally usher in an era of continuous federal bankruptcy policy. It may seem counterintuitive, therefore, to describe the passage of these early bankruptcy acts as instances of political development or state building. In fact, many bankruptcy scholars treat the 1898 law as the important starting point for the development of federal debt relief, describing its predecessors only in passing or characterizing them as abortive attempts at federal policymaking. We take the opposite approach. We treat the enactment of these early, short-lived bankruptcy statutes as a form of federal state building, a path-dependent process by which successive generations of debtors constructed a federal government that could protect them. Each piece of bankruptcy legislation built on its predecessor by incorporating protective provisions from the previous law and then adding new mechanisms for the benefit of the overburdened debtor. The result was a kind of ratchet effect, the halting but steady development of federal policy mechanisms for the protection of overburdened debtors. The first U.S. bankruptcy law, passed in 1800, was designed primarily to serve the interests of creditors, and its features enable us to appreciate how thoroughly federal debt relief was transformed over the century that followed. This original statute did not allow debtors to trigger the bankruptcy process. It provided for bankruptcy only as an involuntary procedure. Creditors would use the law to have their debtors declared bankrupt. These debtors were then forced to liquidate their assets in order to repay creditors, but did not automatically gain a discharge or forgiveness of their debts in return. In fact, the 1800 Act made it challenging for debtors to secure a discharge at all, as it required agreement among two-thirds of the creditors in number and amount before a judge could discharge their debts. Finally, it allowed bankrupt people to keep very little property, exempting only apparel and bedding from forced sale for the repayment of creditors. The next Bankruptcy Act, passed in 1841, included a debtor's discharge and introduced additional devices to protect insolvent debtors, most notably a procedure for voluntary bankruptcy. While it still allowed creditors to initiate involuntary bankruptcy procedures against their debtors, it also allowed debtors to enter bankruptcy of their own accord. After liquidating their assets to repay their creditors, voluntary bankrupts could secure a discharge from their remaining debts unless a majority of creditors in number and amount filed written dissents. Debtors could also keep slightly more property at the end of the bankruptcy process, including household and kitchen furniture. The Bankruptcy Act of 1867 offered even more protections to debtors, especially those who owned real property, than its precursors. It allowed debtors to exempt household and kitchen furniture, wearing apparel, uniforms, arms, and the equipment of soldiers and former soldiers from sale to repay their creditors. Most significantly, the Federal Act allowed debtors to take advantage of laws, frequently termed property exemptions, that states had already passed. States' property exemptions specified certain types and/or amounts of property that debtors could withhold from creditors, even if they were unable to repay their debts. In many states, these laws provided significant protection, since they were designed to ensure that debtors would not lose their homes or farms even if they declared bankruptcy. The Bankruptcy Act of 1898 incorporated the debtor protective features that had been developed earlier in the century. Like the 1841 Act, it included provisions for voluntary bankruptcy, and like the 1867 Act, it allowed debtors to claim state property exemptions. The law also made it harder than ever to trigger involuntary bankruptcy and easier for debtors to discharge their debts. Under this new law, a federal court could grant a discharge without securing the agreement of any creditors. On its passage, one commentator observed, "The debtor needs protection against the creditor. The creditor can take care of himself. Thus, many a good citizen may find comfort in the reflection that if we have gone far toward preventing involuntary bankruptcy, it has been that our laws might be just rather than severe, and expressive of the principle that a score of rascals had better go unpunished rather than that one honest man should suffer oppression. Sympathy sits where sternness sat. Bankruptcy is not a crime but a condition, not always a disgrace but rather a disease. And present laws, while providing relief for him who owes, seem but negatively valuable to him who owns." Federal bankruptcy law now treated people who could not pay their debts as victims of circumstances rather than perpetrators of an immoral act, and accordingly offered them relief. To characterize a process as state building, we generally expect to see not only the creation of new ideas or policies, however, but also developments that enhance governing capacities. State building, in other words, is usually associated with the creation of new agencies, the expansion of budgets and/or labor roles, and the adoption of new technologies. The notion that states must be built is not merely a metaphor. On the contrary, this component of political development refers at least in part to the construction of infrastructure, without which governments lack the practical ability to act. More of this form of state building undergirds debt relief law than is immediately obvious. Federal bankruptcy law placed new and significant administrative demands on the federal government. Beginning with its earliest forays into bankruptcy, Congress recognized that these policies would require an expansion of the federal state's administrative capacity. To comply with bankruptcy statutes, courts needed to determine how much a bankrupt debtor owes and to whom, how many remaining assets the debtor has to distribute to creditors, which creditors have priority in this repayment process, how much of the remaining debt will then be forgiven, and how much the debtor can keep in the process. To carry out debt relief policies, Congress established a set of administrators within the judiciary who would assist judges in performing the administrative work required by the bankruptcy process. These specialized administrators formed a professional network that in turn worked to expand its role and make it permanent, as well as to institute changes in the bankruptcy process itself. In each bankruptcy statute it passed over the course of the 19th century, Congress created new administrative roles to carry out the work of debt relief. The resulting structure ultimately matured into what we now call bankruptcy courts. Though placed within the federal courts, the apparatus required to carry out the work of bankruptcy law was, like other parts of America's bureaucracy, a form of political development and state building. It is deceptively easy to imagine that courts participate in governance simply by considering legal questions and offering judgments. But this exclusive focus on judicial opinions, and indeed on judges, misses the fact that, like the other two branches, the judiciary requires administrative capacity. Many of the same political forces and processes that created the institutional structures of the modern U.S. Congress and bureaucracy have enhanced the capacity of courts as well. Perhaps the best evidence for the bankruptcy courts as a product of state building is the fact that, starting in the New Deal, expert observers have continued to recommend that the bankruptcy process be removed from the judiciary and carried out instead by a new administrative agency established to handle personal bankruptcies. This never happened, but like so many more familiar examples of state building, federal debt relief required the construction of institutions that could enhance the federal government's capacity. Debt relief as social policy. Debt relief is important to our understanding of American political development, not simply because it required state building, but also because it represented a particular kind of state building, the construction of a welfare-oriented protective national state. In this respect, our story of American debt relief joins work that challenges assertions of a laissez-faire 19th-century regime. It also speaks to recent accounts of the centrality of credit programs in the American welfare state by emphasizing the role of debt relief in shaping the potentially welfare-enhancing features of credit. Finally, incorporating debt relief into our understanding of American social policy draws attention to the ways in which debt relief, like other social policies, hinges on political constructions of the deserving poor. Though the prevailing view of the 19th century was once that of a circumscribed and underdeveloped federal government, a newer generation of scholarship contests this notion. After all, in this period of purported statelessness, the federal government effected westward expansion, displaced indigenous people, and suppressed insurrections by enslaved persons. It also mediated the relationship between the states, nurtured national economic development, and built an extensive public communications apparatus in the form of the post office. It had a long tradition of providing relief after natural disasters. The federal government often relied on states and private intermediaries to do its work, but it was not entirely absent. State governments were even more active in welfare-oriented regulation during the 19th century, further undermining the notion of America's stateless past. Debt relief is an underappreciated feature of this protective regime, an early and largely neglected form of welfare state governance. Although anti-statist rhetoric has always characterized one strain of American politics, Americans clearly sought and secured help from their governments throughout the 19th century. They transformed federal institutions to develop a durable national commitment to economic protection in the form of debt relief. Through a combination of state and federal law, governments intervened in private economic life to offer a measure of security to economically vulnerable people, thereby establishing a protective regime even in the 19th century. Studies of the 20th century welfare state have followed a path similar to that of the 19th century federal government. Where scholars of the 20th century once described the United States as having a relatively small and ungenerous welfare state, a more recent generation of scholarship has complicated this view, highlighting all the indirect ways that the federal government channels benefits to citizens, through regulations and tax code incentives for employer fringe benefits, personal income tax expenditures, regulations, tort law, and a host of credit programs. In this light, the U.S. welfare state appears distinctive not because it is comparatively meager, but because it relies so heavily on private intermediaries that shield the scope of the welfare state and its upwardly tilted distributional outcomes from public view. Credit has been an important feature of this hidden or submerged welfare state. Work by Monica Prasad and Sarah Quinn describes a long history of extensive government activity in credit markets. The federal government created credit supports to facilitate westward expansion in the 19th century and regulated credit to facilitate Americans' access to housing and higher education in the 20th. Since credit is so vital to helping citizens meet basic needs, protect against risk, and create opportunity for advancement, some scholars have gone so far as to name America's system of social provision a credit welfare state. While a great deal of the literature on the credit welfare state has focused on politics and policies that have enabled people to access credit, the question about what happens to those with unpayable debts is equally essential to any notion of credit as welfare. Insofar as government credit supports have operated as a substitute for direct government distribution, it is particularly important to attend to the fate of borrowers who cannot repay their loans. Without a means of renegotiating or even discharging debts, policies aimed at increasing access to credit may also induce new vulnerability to financial ruin, thus undermining the welfare-promoting features of access to credit.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.